as we look at designing the grassed waterway, one of the things that's very important is sizing our waterway such that we can pass the water that we need to, so that when we get high flows, we don't get water out into the adjacent cropland where that land may be more susceptible to erosion than our grassed waterway area. So we need to think about how much land is contributing to our grassed waterway, what's the slope of that land, what's the condition of that land, whether we have conservation practices or not, or what soil type, and all those will factor into how much water may ultimately reach and need to go through our grassed waterway. But one of the critical factors is also how much precipitation we design for. And common design standards for a grassed waterway are to design for a 10-year return period storm with a 24-hour duration of that storm. And that means that on average, we'd expect this storm to occur once in every 10 years. So each year there'd be a 10% chance that we'd get a storm of this size. And then we're looking at a 24-hour rainfall duration. And in central Iowa, that equates to about 4.4 to 4.5 inches in a 24-hour period. So as we start to design our grassed waterway, we need to think about what the peak runoff rate is that's going to be going through our grassed waterway. We have to think about what's the runoff depth per unit area based on the design storm that we talked about and the conditions out in the field. What is our contributing drainage area to and through the grassed waterway? And then one of the important areas is our time of concentration. And that is an important factor for calculating that peak runoff rate. And the time of concentration is that essentially the time for runoff to travel from the most distant part of the watershed all the way to the bottom. And so characteristics such as slope, configuration of the watershed, or our area that we're designing for, all factor into determining our time of concentration. A smaller time of concentration would mean a higher peak runoff rate than would a greater time of concentration. So as we start to calculate peak runoff rate, one of the primary factors is the runoff depth. We can calculate that with a method called the NRCS runoff curve number method. That takes into account the hydrologic soil group that we have out in our field, what's the land use, so that different land uses would have a different curve number, and what's the condition or hydrologic condition of our land on the landscape. And all of those will influence that curve number. Another factor would be, what are the conditions? Are we in a wet soil condition or a dry soil condition? If we have wet soil conditions, we would expect a greater runoff depth than if we had normal or average or a dry soil condition. So as we start to look at the curve number approach, a higher curve number means that for a given rainfall event, we would expect a greater runoff depth. Also, if we had a lower curve number for the same rainfall amount, we would expect a lower or smaller depth of runoff. Some examples on how curve number might vary based on the treatment that we have out on the land, the hydrologic condition, or the hydrologic soil group. So if we had a straight row with poor hydrologic conditions out on the land, under soil group B, we might have a curve number of 81. If we had straight rows with good hydrologic condition, and again under hydrologic soil group B, we might have a curve number of 78. So 81 versus 78. If we look at straight row with good hydrologic condition, soil group B, we might have a curve number of 78. Versus if we go to a contour system with good hydrologic conditions, soil group B, we might have a curve number of 75. So 78 versus 75. Then if we look at a contour system with crop residue on the land under soil group B, good hydrologic condition, we might further reduce the curve number to 74. Also adding a terrace, so we have a contour land with terrace, with crop residue, hydrologic condition good, hydrologic soil group B, we might have a curve number of 70. So in this case, with the same soil group, as we've moved from a straight row to contoured to crop residue to terrace, we may reduce our curve number from 78 down to 70. What that would result in is less runoff depth from the same landscape. So if we think of a systems approach, it's very important to look at what systems can we add within the landscape that are contributing to the grass waterway, because that could reduce the flow depth and peak flow rate that we would need to design for in the grass waterway. So if we think of an example 60-acre watershed where we have a hydrologic soil group B in our climatic section 5, so in central Iowa, again, we have a 10-year, 24-hour rainfall design storm, which is a storm of approximately 4.3 inches. If we look at a straight row hydrologic condition pour and a curve number, and in this case, we'll use a curve number under wet antecedent moisture conditions, we'd calculate a runoff depth of about 3.29 inches from that 4.3 inch storm. Based on that 3.29 inches of runoff depth from 60 acres, we'd calculate a runoff volume of 5.36 million gallons of water. If we then look at a contoured cropping system with terraces, and our hydrologic condition is poor, we'd have a curve number of about 87 under our wet antecedent moisture conditions. We would predict a runoff depth of about 2.9 inches of water, which would relate to a runoff volume of about 4.68 million gallons of water. Now, if we look at our contoured plus terrace system under a good hydrologic condition, we'd expect a curve number of about 85 under wet antecedent moisture conditions. We'd calculate a runoff depth of about 2.7 inches, and that'd be about 4.36 million gallons of water. If we look at a contour system with terraces under a good hydrologic condition versus straight rows under poor hydrologic condition, we can see we reduce runoff depth by about 0.6 inches and the total runoff volume by about 1 million gallons for the same design storm. This is very important as we start to think about designing the size of the grassed waterway. So what we do within the land, thinking of the conservation systems approach, is very important for ultimately sizing that grassed waterway. One of the critical factors for the design of a grassed waterway is determining what the peak runoff rate is. We need that to look at what's the velocity in the channel, so we can compare the velocity that we would expect to the permissible velocity based on the soil and the grass conditions that we have in the waterway. We'll now go through looking at and calculating the peak runoff rate. So the peak runoff rate takes into account the watershed area that we're looking at, the runoff depth from our design storm, which we've talked about previously, any adjustment for the percent pond and swampland that we may have within our watershed, and then the time of concentration and the time it takes for runoff to begin. So an important factor in grassed waterway design is the maximum permissible velocity. That is the highest rate at which water can flow through the waterway while maintaining stability and without causing erosion. So two factors that influence our permissible velocity are soil erodibility and the retardance and roughness of the vegetation. We could have soils that are easily erodible, such as sandy to sandy loam soils, erodible soils such as silty soils, or erosion-resistant soils such as clay loams to predominantly clay soils. If we look at the retardance and roughness, that's a function of the vegetation type that we have out there, the vegetation condition or grass condition if it's a grass system, and also the vegetation or grass density out there. As we start to get more dense vegetation, we would have greater resistance to flow, and that will be an important factor for the design of our grassed waterway to convey water off the landscape. Here we show permissible velocities for selected vegetative types commonly used in Iowa grassed waterways for a couple different erosion resistant and easily erodible soils. So we can see here, for example, a Kentucky bluegrass, smooth brome, blue gamma, tall fescue under different ranges of slopes may have a permissible velocity that ranges from 2.9 on easily eroded soils at a greater than 10% slope all the way up to a 6.9 feet per second permissible velocity on a 0 to 5% slope condition on erosion resistant soils. And you can see here if we had grass mixtures or reed canary grass or all the way down to alfalfa, that influences what the permissible velocity is for these different soil conditions. If we start looking at different retardance classes, they vary for the different vegetation that we may have. For example, a reed canary grass may have high resistance to flow, high retardance class, which is a class A. A Kentucky bluegrass with good stand, headed out, may have a kind of a middle retardance class or class C, middle resistance to flow. But then the Kentucky bluegrass would move down a class, less resistance to flow, retardance class D, if it's been cut, and so there's only a height of about 2 inches there. So now if we look at sizing of the waterway, we're going to try to bring in a lot of the factors we've discussed, but we have to look at the channel cross-section. And that would be size for the minimum cross-sectional area that we need while satisfying the stability and capacity requirements for the given waterway shape and flow rate. So we start to look at sizing our grass waterway. We know what our peak flow rate is. We've calculated that. We know what the permissible velocity is for our soil and land conditions, vegetation conditions. From that, we can solve the area that we need for that flow, or the cross-sectional flow area, the area perpendicular to flow. We can then look at a hydraulic radius, which is our cross-sectional area divided by our wetted perimeter. And using this, we can calculate that area that we need, the cross-sectional area, what that depth that we need within the grassed waterway. We would also add some extra depth or freeboard. We can also think of it as factor of safety onto the depth of the grassed waterway. That provides us a bit of extra protection to minimize water flowing out onto the landscape. And so we would add this freeboard to make sure that the water can flow down the grassed waterway where we have greater permissible velocity, where we have greater resistance to erosion. Now we'll look at the effect of peak flow rate and other conditions on the grass waterway design size. So we can look at a drainage area of about 100 acres, two different time of concentrations. At that lower time of concentration, we have a lower flow rate. And we can see our depth is about 2.3 feet and a top width of about 14.7 feet. But as we reduce that time of concentration, our flow rate increases and we see our depth shallows up, but now we have a much wider top width. We have a depth of about 1.7 feet and a top width of about 44 feet. This sizing is to make sure we can pass that flow rate and not exceed that permissible velocity within the grassed waterway. These examples highlight how the size of the drainage area or slope of the drainage area may influence the size of the grassed waterway that we design. As we get to larger areas, larger slopes, we're going to end up having bigger grassed waterways or a larger cross-sectional area of our grassed waterway. We should also keep in mind that in some of these cases, we might be able to reduce that peak flow rate if we also implement upland conservation practices so that we reduce that peak flow rate and total volume of water that we need to design for in our grassed waterway. So if we summarize grassed waterway design, there are a few different factors we need to think of that greatly influence the size of the grassed waterway that we're going to recommend for implementation. Some of those include the precipitation that we're designing for, what's our design storm, the type of land use that we have out there, and upland conservation practices that might influence the flow and flow rate into our grassed waterway. What's the contributing area and slope of that contributing area, which would influence how much runoff we get? Again, the conservation practices would also influence how much runoff we might expect. The soils and the vegetation in our grassed waterway are important for looking at what are the permissible velocities, what's the resistance to flow, and are critical in determining a design cross-sectional area that we need to pass the flow for the design of our grassed waterway. All these factors come together to help us determine the size of the grass waterway that we need to adequately convey water off the land without eroding the soil so that we can reduce the sediment loss from our fields, which could ultimately have a positive effect on downstream water bodies.